Great. Okay. Thank you again for everyone for coming out and for the San Juan Freethinkers for inviting me out, so, especially on a night like tonight. Let's get started. So this is a whale fossil that's out of Egypt, and this is a Dorudon. We'll talk about that in a little bit. One of the reasons why I put this slide is, and you can see how complete the fossil is. Almost everything is there and laid out nicely, so they were able to put everything together. I know this screen's a little bit small. I'll do my best to, I don't know if you can see the pointer there a little bit, and we'll see what we can do with what we've got. So it should work fine. All right, so I'm going to be basically presenting four lines of evidence to you tonight. I'm hopeful that by the time you leave, you'll be fully convinced that it's overwhelming that whales have evolved from a small deer-like animal. Actually, the one we have so far, the farthest one back, Indohyas, is about the size of a raccoon. And so I know how contentious this topic is among a lot of people, not only the religious, but for most of us, I don't think it's intuitive that you can go from a herbivore or carnivore animal the size of a cat into a blue whale, you know, basically over about 15, 20 million years. And I don't know about you, but I don't consider that intuitive. If somebody told me all the changes that have to come about, I don't think it's very apparent. So I'm right there with you. If there's any skeptics in the audience that are thinking, this is a story that science has put together that it sounds more fictional than it does truth. So, so much evidence has come out in the last 20 years between the DNA studies and a lot of fossils have come out of Pakistan and the area around India that I think it's to the point now where it literally is so overwhelming, and I hope you can walk out of here tonight. If you had doubts before, if I do my job right, I hope to convince you that, you know, son of a gun, macroevolution with this group is true. And if you can accept going from a raccoon or a cat size to a blue whale, then the rest of the macroevolution challenges that are out there, whether it's amphibians to reptiles or fish to amphibians or humans from a shared ancestor with ape, if this is true, then I'm hoping that you can extend that to begin to look at the data for the other types of evolution. And this is really a talk about macroevolution. Just about everybody accepts microevolution now, the going from a mouse species to another mouse species or from one squirrel to another squirrel species. That's pretty much set. We have lots of data for that, lots of examples, ring species around the Arctic and lizards and things like that. So natural selection producing species that are still similar to the species that they arose from is, I think, pretty much accepted by everybody, including Ken Ham and all the young Earth creationists, et cetera. However, when you get into macroevolution, that's where the kind of rubber meets the road, and there's a huge divergent in America. And studies have consistently shown that almost a little bit under half of Americans don't accept macroevolution. So we're going to talk about fossils, and there's over 30 genera of fossils that have been found. So we have so many fossil whales now that if you want transition forms, we got them. We're going to talk about extant whales. Those are the whales that are living today. We're going to look at embryology, vestigial structures, and recall that vestigial structures are not useless necessarily. They just have lost their original function. The third line of evidence is DNA. We're going to look at protein sequences and transposons. That's, again, a lot of new things have come out. And turns out that you and I, out of our 3 billion base pairs for our DNA, almost 1 million to 1.5 billion, are all transposons. We're basically walking around with old viruses in us. And then lastly, we're going to talk about atavisms, and that's probably the most persuasive visually. So, all right, disclaimers. I am not a paleontologist, geologist, or not even close. So hopefully there's some people out in the audience that can rescue me if anybody has any kind of geology or fossil questions that are more in depth than what I can do. And I'm speaking for myself. I'm not speaking for the medical profession or any other physicians in my group. These are my opinions. I'm also not a geneticist, but obviously with my science background and background in medicine, I hope to show you the DNA sequences that they're actually using to study the different genomes. All right, so before we do that, just a brief history of whale classification. We live in an age when you don't have to go back too far before people really didn't know what we know today. John Ray was one of the first people to write that whales were actually mammals. Before then, anything that swam in the ocean was considered a fish. So this is really close. You know, you're within 100 years of the American Revolution, and they're just discovering that whales are mammals, or 200 years, rather. In 1883, a researcher by the name of Flower noted that there were some vestigial features and characteristic of land animals that were within whales, and we'll go over those. And he also linked them to the ungulates, the hooved animals. Others noted that whales actually breathe air, and whales have a horizontal fluke instead of a vertical fluke that fish use. So people were beginning to put into a little context here that that there was more to these whales than just big fish. The controversy revolving around whale macroevolution is still recent. Those of you who remember the Dover trial in 2005, where intelligent design was kind of put on trial in that Pennsylvania town, one of the things that came up is that the textbook they were using that was suggested to be used was of pandas and people, which was actually published in 93, but during the trial, they used this quote out of the book as if it was current, and quote, "The problem is that there are no clear transitional fossils linking land mammals to whales." I hope to show you that that was way off. We have over 30 of them. And then Ian Taylor, who's a Canadian, wrote in his book in 1991, "No one really expects the whale suddenly to express hind legs, although this is precisely the argument that Darwin implied." And again, I'm going to show you a picture that we satisfied that. And lastly, Alan Hayward, who is an old Earth creationist, in his book in 1985 mentioned, "A land animal that was in the process of becoming a whale would fall between two stools. It would not be fitted for life on land or at sea and would have no hope for survival." So it's, in some respects, it's nobody's fault, because a lot of the data and the observations we have now have just come up during the last 10, 15, 20 years. And I personally don't think it's an abnormal thing to expect science to come up with some of these answers. People want to see macroevolution. They don't want to see bacteria forming new bacterial species. That's not good enough. So I've chosen whale evolution because I think it's got good macroevolution evidences to it, but you could do other macroevolution. We now have other ways of showing that macroevolution is true. We're just doing whales tonight. So hopefully you've got the picture that we're really talking about macroevolution, and whales are as our tool tonight. Okay, so the first thing we're gonna do is take a look at fossils. You probably can't see it from back there, but this is some of the major fossil species that have been found. Pachycetus, Amblyocetus, etc. It goes down. The whales at the top here, as you go down, one of the first things you do is you look at the legs, and if you can see, the legs start to shrink. And when you get down to a Basilosaurus in through here, they've got little nubs that are still sticking out. We're going to look at that a little bit in just a little bit. And when you look at the forelimb. Of modern whales, they've got the same pattern that we do. One bone, two bones, some wrist bones, some metaphalanges, and then fingers. And then if you look at whale, they have the same configuration that we have. So that's one clue that you should begin to ask, why would that be? Why not just come up with something different? Why does it look like a land animal? So the legs shrink. First thing. And if you look at these vestigial pelvis, by the time you get, this is Basilosaurus here, you can see that they've got most of the whale. There was some of the tail missing. And this little tiny structure right here is the vestigial pelvis. And if you blow it up, what you'll see is a femur, tibia, fibula, and then foot bones. Mm-hmm. And if you look at it, this is an actual photo. And here you can see the bones. This is the pelvis here, the obturator, which we have. And then the legs. Look, it even has a kneecap. Wow. And then going into foot bones. This is Basilosaurus, and this is another Basilosaurus. And this one, I love this vestigial structure because it's actually got the ball and socket here of the hip.
Oh.
So again, we have photos now. We have these fossils, these vestigial pelvis that the modern whales have, which we'll get to in a minute, and the fossil whales are transition. You can actually watch the legs shrink in the back until they're completely embedded. So that's the legs. Let's move into the head region. If you look at fossils in the fossil record, we've got so many of them now. If you look at the blowhole of a 47 million year old whale, you can watch the blowhole move back through time. And by the time you get to a Dorudon, which is, this is the old name, the blowhole is about the middle, and then modern, this is a dolphin, the blowhole is back here. So we have what you'd like to see is you want to see this blowhole moving up towards the top of the head, and we have it. There's plenty of whale fossils that will show that. But that's not even the best case. If you look at whales and dolphins when they're developing from an embryo, here's the blowhole on top, and they start out with two holes, their nose in the front, and then halfway through their gestation, the blowhole nostrils move up to near the top, and then they end up at the top. So again, I think the best explanation for this is that they were land animals at one time, and they've kept that within their development. If you were a designer making this from fresh start, I don't think you would start at the nose and then migrate it all the way up. You would just start up there and finish up there. If you look at the single blowhole of a dolphin, and you look at the skull, there's not one blowhole, there's two. There's two nostrils. Again, why would you put two nasal passageways if you've got one blowhole? You'd have just one. So here's some hints that, taken in the entirety, as we build up the case here, we've got fossils showing the blowhole migrating to the top. We've got embryos that start out at the nose, the front, and end up at the top. Exactly what you would predict, I think, if evolution were true. I've stolen these, hopefully, with some good attribution, to a video that just came out like 3 weeks ago. It's called statedclearly.com. They have a website, and these are some of the photos that they have from that. The video is 11 minutes long, and it's about the evidences for evolution, and whale evolution is prominent in their video. All right, so the nasal hole migrates up, the legs get smaller. Now we want to turn to a very important structure, and that's the middle ear. If you're going to go from a land animal to an ocean animal, you've got to do something with the ear. This is not very hydrodynamic, sticking out like this. So you got to get rid of this, and then you got to do something with the middle ear canal that goes back to the eardrum. And the eardrum is designed for hearing in the air. So you got to do something with that. And it turns out that one of the ways that paleontologists know that they've got a whale fossil is all whales have a very specific middle ear. If those of you can see this, this is a deer tympanic bulla or auditory bulla. So this is where the three bones are, the malleus, the incus, and the stapes that you use for your middle ear. And it's encased in a bone here, and the middle edge here is very thin in deers and in you and us and everybody else. But in whales, this middle bone expands and becomes very thick, and it has a name called the involucrum. And if you find a fossil with the involucrum, you know you've got a whale. It's a pathognomonic for that whole line of species. And these are whale middle ear auditory and tympanic bulla. And all these red arrows are pointing to the involucrum. So it's a very good way for paleontologists to know, even if they've got a few teeth or part of the skull or something like that, if you've got an involucrum, you've got a fossil whale, because it's the only line that it occurs in. So we can see the middle ear changes. The other thing that happens is we start out with a certain configuration of the incus. And so as whales develop through time, the incus changes in its configuration. It goes to 90 degrees. And so Pachycetus is halfway in between land animals and the modern whales we have today. So we've got another transitional form through the incus of the middle ear, along with the characteristic whale, the involucrum. If you look at these whale fossils here, as we go down, there's more evidence that whales have evolved. It turns out that if you look at these are really called proto-whales, because they've got four legs and they're still walking on land, they're still having land, young, etc. And their fossils are found in only certain areas of the world where whales were evolving. So on the edges of the Indian Ocean, for example, if you go back and look at continental drift, remember that India slams into Asia and produces the Himalaya Mountains. Well, right before it did that, there was a shallow sea, and that's where whales evolved. And so if you look at whale fossils, these fossils are next to that area. The other fossils, as the whales moved out into the marine environment, are found all over the world. So just as you would predict, the more primitive proto-whales are found where they're evolving, and as soon as they get more into the ocean and marine environments, then their fossils are found everywhere. That's what I call paleobiography. If you also look at the paleo environment, of course, animals don't fossilize, and fossils don't fossilize in place. They fossilize with other flora and fauna around them. These fossils have terrestrial or freshwater fossils embedded around them. And then when you get out to these other more advanced whales, you start finding marine fossils embedded around them. So again, just as you predicted, if whale evolution is true, as the whales moved out from their terrestrial area, the fossils match the paleo environment that they're into. The pollen, the plants, everything matches with them. Exactly what you would predict. Another tool that is often used by the paleontologists who study whales is oxygen ratios. It turns out that fresh water has more oxygen 16 than oxygen 18 isotopes. So salt water is heavier. So if you look at fossil teeth, these Dorudon and all the various ones out here that are more marine, they've got more oxygen 18 ratio than 16. But if you go back up here and look at the ones that are closer up, the Amblyocetus and Pachycetus, they've got more freshwater isotope in them. So just as you predict, as the whales move out from the land to near the freshwater areas to mixtures, brackish water, and then finally into the marine, the oxygen ratios match what you would predict. So the legs shrink, the nasal hole migrates, both in embryology and in the fossil record. The middle ear changes, the incus changes its direction, you've got the involucrum forming, you've got the distribution of whales matches exactly what you would think, the environment of their fossils that are around, the other fossils that are in, and the oxygen ratios all match what you'd expect. I throw this slide up for a couple reasons. They found over 30 genera of whale fossils or proto-whale fossils, and sometimes there are some, if you look at people who are critical of whale evolution, they will say that the fossils are incomplete, they only found the skull or something like that. And that was true 30 years ago, 40 years ago, but not now. We've got really good complete fossils, even Pachycetus and stuff. We have plenty of different specimens now. We can fill in most of the bones, and so that's not an issue anymore. This is another lineage. They've even put in more species if you look here. There's some that weren't on the other side. The other reason why I put this up here is to remind me, unfortunately, this is very misleading. Evolution does not occur in a ladder. It's not starting with a goal in mind and going down a ladder. This is a bush. There's dead ends, there's some that lead to it. It's like I say, they found over 30 genera, and these probably represent what was going on at different times 40 or 50 million years ago. But I doubt that a paleontologist would probably tell you that this was the exact species that gave rise to the next one. All we know is that there was a community of whales evolving all over the place, and some models made it, some models didn't. And then the mesokinids at the top here, if you read some old whale literature, that turned out to be a red herring and a dead end. Everyone thought that that was proto-whale. It's more of a carnivore type animal, because all they had was some teeth and some skull fragments. And whales also have very specific fossil teeth. A paleontologist can sometimes tell you've got an old whale or a proto-whale species just by looking at the teeth. Unfortunately, that species had teeth that looked very similar, and so for many, many years, the paleontologists were going down the wrong angle until they finally found an ankle bone of some of these older whales up here, and then they knew that that they were dealing with an artiodactyl, which is the even-toed ungulates, which is, well, now we know for sure that's where they came from. So if you see some older whale literature, they've got it wrong at the beginning because they didn't have the right fossils. And they certainly didn't have DNA back then at the time. Okay, so that's kind of a brief look at the whale fossils that tell us the nice transitional forms and all we've got going to. So let's look at modern whales now. If you were to go someplace to a museum or something like that, or dissect a whale, what would be some of the things you would find? First thing you would find is a lot of, almost all the whales have a pelvis that's sitting out in the blubber area, just doing basically nothing. Those of you can see, this is a right whale, northern right whale, a fin whale. Down here is a killer whale, who's really a dolphin, and then the sperm whale. And paleontologists can name the ilium, the ischium, the femur, the pelvis. They all have basically bones that we're sitting on. Right now you're sitting on two of your ischium and your pelvis bone, and women have a larger pelvis than males, right, for giving babies and stuff. So a paleontologist can look at these bones that are sitting out basically in most whale species, just sitting there without any particular function, although in modern whales, because if you think of your pelvis, those muscles that are down there that are attached in the pelvic area, a lot of them are around your reproductive organs. And so in modern whales, these vestigial pelvis, which are not used for walking anymore, still are involved in reproduction. There's one that has kind of a lock and key to it. It snaps forward, and there are muscles attached to this. So this goes back to, what's the definition of a vestigial structure? Not that they don't have function anymore, they do in modern whales. It's just that if you were going to make a reproductive organ for a modern whale, why would you make it look like an old pelvis that we use for walking? Also, whales have nerves that go out to where their noses used to be. They have vestigial olfactory nerves that run out to nothing. Because you can't use your nose for a land animal for smelling underwater. There's a different organs used for smelling underwater than there are obviously above land. But they still have the nerves that run out to where their nose used to be. Remember we talked about the fact you gotta close this, you gotta lose the pinna, which is the outside ear, and you gotta close this canal that goes back towards the eardrum. And whales still have a little streak that runs out to where their ear used to be. It's a closed auditory meatus, it's the canal. Whales have a diaphragm, but they don't use it for breathing. Whales use their thoracic cage to breathe in and out, but they still have a vestigial diaphragm. When a whale is developing in the fetus, when it's in the womb, it's at one point covered with hair, and then it loses it all, basically. So again, if you were going to design a whale from scratch, why would you make it go through a stage where it is covered by fur? And lastly, on this diagram here, whales have four-chambered stomachs, or the vast majority do, and it matches the ruminant stomach. And again, if they evolved from animals that were on land, that were chewing grass, it was a great stomach to have at the time, but not that efficient now.
What does it do with it?
It's adapted for what they're doing. It depends, you know, whether they're a baleen whale or whether they're still eating, like sperm whales, meat. All right, let's take a look at some other things. Remember the pinna here on the outside? You know, your cat can move it around and stuff like that. And And actually, we still have muscles attached to ours, but we won't go into that tonight. But the whales, also these whales have ear muscles that go to non-existent ears. They're just embedded in the sides, vestigial. Belugas still have a little bit of an ear left. They haven't lost it all in their evolution. And then embryos, during their development, before they're born, whale embryos will form the ear, and then they lose it. And they'll also form hind limb buds, and they'll lose those. So again, if you were making a whale from scratch, I don't think you would do that. Evolution is the best explanation, I think, for all of this. And we already talked about the embryo nostrils starting out the front, then having to migrate up before they're born. Some baleen whale embryos that have the filtering, they have no teeth. It turns out that in their development, they form tooth buds. And so this is a picture of a row of teeth in a baleen whale that's going to have no teeth as an adult. And then they lose it. On the DNA level, if you look at olfactory receptors, we all smell. We have hundreds and hundreds of different receptors for different smells that we smell. And the DNA that makes those receptors, those land receptors won't work underwater. But whales have the receptors, or they have the DNA to make the receptors for land smelling. But they've been knocked out through mutations. And so we call those pseudogenes, because you can identify them. They're the same DNA for making receptors that are used on land that they can't use anymore. So more, even if you knew nothing about the fossil record or nothing else we're going to talk about now, just studying whales now should give you enough hints to make you think, wow, these animals really did come from the land. All right, so now we're moving on to our third line of evidence. We've talked about fossils, that you can tell evolution must have occurred. You can dissect present-day whales. You can look at their embryology and their development and get lots of clues that they hark back to a land animal. And now we're going to look at DNA sequences. Those of you who have taken some biology, I don't know if you can see this from back there, but those are the ATCGs that make up our DNA. Just in review, the DNA is a double helix. It's like a ladder that's twisted, and it's only got four bases. A bonds with T and C bonds with G. So if you know one side, you know the other. And that's the entire alphabet for what makes everything in life, are those four bases. So we can take proteins and find the DNA that's making a protein. In this case, we're going to look at the beta casein gene. This is the gene that makes milk. So if you're a mammal, everybody has this. And those of you, again, if you've taken some biology, you'll notice that all the bases are in groups of three, and those are called codons that the messenger RNA and the transfer RNA reads off. But we don't need to know that. So in this example, we're going to compare a right whale with a cow. And this is the DNA sequence of the active part of the gene that codes for milk, the beta casein gene. And if you read from left to right, we're going to see where they don't match up. So I don't know if you can see that, but the first three DNA sequences are AAT, and the first one in the cow is AGT. So all we're doing right now is collecting some data. So there's one difference between the right whale and the cow and the beta casein gene. There's one base difference, okay? There's 60 of these up here, of these. So if I press this little button, there's going to be this magic arrow that comes out. And that's the difference. So how about this next one? The next codon is CCC in the whale, and the cow it's CCC, and the next one it's CAA, and we got CAA, so there's no difference in those. And we're just going to go down the road. We're just going to record the differences. That's all we're doing right now. Raw data. Okay, there's the next one. Instead of AGC, we've got AGT. And then the next one next to that, in the right whale, it's TAA. And in the cow, it's GAA, for those that you can see in the front. So rather than not bore you here, we'll just keep going. And we'll just mark them all. And if we count all those, I think there should be 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, good. And you can do this with multiple proteins. This happens to be the beta casein gene, but as you can tell, I've listed some other ones. Those are the ones in the back, I can't see it, but you can use cytochrome C, myoglobin, hemoglobin. You can do this for a whole bunch of proteins and sequence the DNA, the genes that are producing the proteins that the different mammals are. Now we're gonna take that and we're gonna produce a table, and we're just gonna write in the table how many differences there were between these two genes. And we're gonna do it with a whole bunch of species. Okay, this is the table, and we're gonna compare a sperm whale, a porpoise, a giraffe, a hippo, a cow, a camel, a deer, a pig, a peccary, and a rhino, and we're gonna compare them among all those. This is also the answer key to a lab in the Indiana University that I stole this out of. So if anybody's going there, I have the answers. See me after.
We won't turn you in.
Okay, thank you very much. They put it online, you know, so it's their fault if they broadcast it. All right, so if we look here, if we start up here, for example, we don't have to go through all this whole table, but hopefully you'll get the idea. If you compare a sperm whale with a right whale, when they intersect, how many differences are there in their beta casein gene? There's 3 out of that whole one. Remember, we had 9 on the other slide. This is 3. So how about the difference between a porpoise and a right whale? Or a porpoise and a sperm whale? Can you see how they're pretty similar? How about if we compare a porpoise with a rhino? 12 differences. Or a sperm whale with a pig? Big differences. Or a right whale with a peccary? So the ones that we don't think are very closely related don't have a lot of differences, and then if you compare ones that are closely related. So this whole table makes sense, except for one animal doesn't make sense there. I don't know if you can see the ones in the front. What does a hippo have to do with a right whale? There's only 4 differences. Or look at this. Here's a hippo and a sperm whale. It has the same beta casein differences as a porpoise and a right whale, or a sperm whale and a right whale. That's rather strange. All right, so keep that in mind. So when you compare the proteins of the various whales and all the ungulates walking around, it turns out that the hippo is more closely related on the DNA level than to whales than it is to any of the land animals. All right, our second line of DNA evidence are going to be transposons. Has anybody heard of those? It turns out that about half of your DNA is made up of transposons. It's an incredible amount of humans have like 3.1 billion base pairs of those ATCGs, and like a billion of them are these transposons. And what transposons are they're used to be called jumping genes. They're sections of DNA that can flip out, copy themselves, and then they insert back into the chromosomes of the DNA. And they like to do that. They jump around all over the place. There's millions of them. Some of them are called retrotransposons because they can copy themselves from DNA to RNA and then back to DNA. And if you look at these retrotransposons, they basically look identical or very similar to retroviruses. So HIV that causes AIDS is a retrovirus. It's an RNA virus that infects you if you get it, and it has to convert its RNA to DNA, and then it inserts the DNA into your DNA, and then uses your copy mechanisms to make lots of copies of itself. So these transposons, they jump all over the place, and they use the host mechanisms to make copies of themselves, and there's just huge numbers of copies. And so what we're gonna do is we're gonna compare transposons between species. Just like we did the beta casein gene, we compared that between species. The key with transposons are that, by and large, they tend to insert randomly all over your genome. So think about this. If you find the same transposon inserted in the same location in a similar chromosome, what does that tell you about common ancestry? If there's millions of these, and they're inserted all over the place, and you find some that are just only found in a couple different species, the only rational decision you can make is that they had a common ancestry. Otherwise, you're going to say that a virus happens to just insert with the same DNA at the same spot to two different species. And you've got, there are estimates between humans and chimps, there's 200,000 transposons. So it becomes very difficult to believe that when you compare transposons, if you can show that the same DNA inserted in the same place, that it is powerful evidence of common ancestry, common descent. Okay, so first of all, we're going to look at whales. And this is a study by Masato in 2001, and it was summarized in Alan Rogers' book, The Evidence for Evolution, he published in 2011. Can you see how recent this stuff is? You know, most people don't know about it because it's just been coming out this last few years. So what Masato did and his colleagues is they looked at 25 different transposons between whale species. And they identified them, and then they chose 16 of them and put them in this table. So they labeled them A through P. There should be 16 of them up there. And all they did was which transposons are located in the same place and the same transposons between species. And they put them in this table, and I've purposely hid the answers to you, so you have to think here a little bit. Okay. And even if you knew nothing about phylogenetic trees and how species are put together, can you see by just comparing transposons, you don't have anything else, you don't have fossils, you don't have anything else, can you see that two of them are really pretty close, these two species? This two row here share all 16 different transposons. This one here, not so much, and then this one down here, very few of the same transposons. So let's take a look and see who they are, because I know you can't stand it anymore. All right. Oops, let me go back here. Okay. So it turns out that the bottlenose dolphin and the narwhal are more closely related than they are to the sperm whale and the humpback whale. And you can take this DNA data, transpose data, and you can go to a paleontologist lab, and let's say they don't know anything about DNA, and you don't know anything about fossils, and if evolution is true, what should happen? It should match up. It doesn't always match up, and somebody has to revise, you know, their pet theory and stuff, but that's the way science works. But basically, what's happening in evolutionary theory is that no matter what fields you look at in science, whether it's chemistry, molecular biology, DNA, fossils, comparative anatomy, it all starts coming together. And during the last 150 years, it's all matching. So we know that the theory of evolution is as strong as the theory of gravity, or cell theory, or relativity theory by Einstein. The reason why this is called a theory in biology is because it has withstood this test of time and is doing quite well. All right, I'm going to give you another one. This one is from the same authors, Masato, and this one's 1999. In this case, they looked at some different mammal species that I've hidden you the species. And here again, we have 16 transposons. These are these jumping genes. They're looking for the same genes that have jumped in the same location between different species. And this one's a little bit more complicated, but can you at least tell that whatever these are the two up top are probably the most closely related? And then probably these two on the bottom are most closely related also. They share the most transposons. And then there's this guy in the middle that he doesn't know what he's doing. You know, it's like, where do we put him? I wonder what he could be. Here's our friend the hippo. Exactly what we would think, kind of in between. The hippo is sharing more of the transposon data, just like the hippo shared the DNA sequences for the genes for the proteins. This is a different set of DNA data that has totally independent from the protein sequences, and we have more evidence that whales and hippos are closely related. Our third line of evidence.
John, for those who can't see too well, could you tell us what those different species were on that last chart?
Let's see, sure can.
Please.
From top to bottom.
What's an atavism?
We're going to get to that.
Oh, good.
So the two on top are the deer and the cow, middle one is hippo, and the last two are the humpback and the beaked whale. Okay, so that our third line of evidence was DNA. Our second line of evidence was whales as they are now, just looking at anatomy and development. And our first line of evidence was fossils. And the fourth line of evidence I'm going to present to you are atavisms. An atavism is an appearance of a structure that pops up very rarely, but it harks back to an ancestral type. So in humans, we probably have two atavisms that we can identify. Tails. There have been about 100 instances of humans born with tails. These have cartilage and vertebrae. They have they can be wagged. There's actually a video on YouTube showing someone with one. In developed worlds, you cut those off as soon as the baby's born. But if you go to Pakistan, Afghanistan, you can actually find humans with tails. But in whales, you don't have atavistic feathers. You don't have atavistic tails. You end up with atavistic legs because that's where they came from. That's where they evolved from. This is not, people who oppose evolution have not had this go unnoticed. And so Carl Weiland in 1998 had this quote in AIG: "The spectacle of a whale being hauled out of the ocean with an actual leg hanging down from its side was a totally different issue. I don't remember my exact response, but I indicate that if true, this would be a serious challenge to explain on the basis of a creation model." Well, it turns out that hind limbs that grow out of whales are not that uncommon. In some species of whales, it's almost 1 in 500. And these are not tumors or abnormal growths. They actually, you can identify a femur, a tibia, a fibula, and a few have even had foot bones. And it's consistent with the fossil record. Again, you'd expect an atavistic structure from a whale to be a leg and not a feather, because that's not what they were related to. So these are actually photographs. The one on your left was a humpback whale that was found in 1919 off the coast of British Columbia, and the leg was 4 feet long. Not all of it was sticking out of the whale, but can you see the bones? You know, you've got, you know, femur going up, and by the way, this attached to the pelvis, that vestigial pelvis that used to be used for walking and stuff, it attached to it. And then in 2006, off the coast of Japan, they pulled up a dolphin, and it's got two appendages back here, and if those of you know your cetaceans, there shouldn't be two small limbs back there sticking out. So we have lots of evidence of atavistic legs that whales have been born with. And then think about that. Some people say, well, it's just a throwback. But remember, to produce a leg, think about the DNA that it takes to produce a leg. Bones, muscles, nerves, skin, cartilage. You know, that is a lot of DNA. What is that DNA doing in there if whales never had legs? All right, let's summarize. So I'm tempted to show you that there are multiple lines of evidence coming in to pretty much show us that whales used to be land animals. They're proto-whales in their past. We've looked at the legs getting smaller. We've seen the blowhole as it migrates up to the top, both in fossils and in the embryology of the developing whale. Whales have a vestigial pelvis, and you can watch the pelvis shrink down and get smaller and smaller to where it is today through the fossil record. Oxygen ratios of teeth, the enamel in the teeth, show that the early proto-whales had had freshwater oxygen isotopes, and the later fossil whales had saltwater oxygen isotopes, just as we would predict. And then the way the whales are scattered, we looked at the biogeography, we looked at the fossils around their fossils, which matched going from freshwater to water's edge out into the saltwater. And then remember that whales have this involucrum, this middle ear bone that any paleontologist, if they've got the middle ear, they don't have to have the rest of the fossil. They know it's a proto-whale or a whale species. We looked at the embryology of developing whales, the vestigial pelvis on the whale species that we have today, the ear streak that runs out to ears that are no longer there. It's just a closed middle meatus. Ear muscles that modern whales have that they no longer have can move their ears. A four-chambered stomach like a ruminant. And we looked at the fact that in embryology, in the development of whales, they start out with two holes in the front and then it migrates up to the top. We looked at DNA sequences in different proteins. In this case, we looked at the beta casein gene, but we could have chosen myoglobin and hemoglobin and a lot of other proteins. And then we looked at transposons, which are very powerful evidence for a common ancestry when you compare different species. I didn't mention the fact that the pseudogenes that whales carry for smelling on land, that are all knocked out. Whales also, that the baleen whales that don't have teeth, they have the gene to make enamel. So you can cross-reference a lot of mammals, placental mammals that don't have teeth anymore. They all carry the gene to make enamel, even though they're not using it. And then lastly, we looked at atavistic legs in whales. And so I think it's powerful visual evidence that if whales were always designed from the beginning to be whales, it would be very strange to put DNA in there to make legs that they're never going to use. All right, thank you very much. If anybody wants to look at some of this data, I do have a website where I put up most of it. It's called www.trueorigins.us is the URL. So this is the whale. There's a section on whale evolution there that's summarized. And I'm hoping that if you've never considered macroevolution being true, that you now have something that you can hang your hat on, that whale evolution, I think, hopefully, is something that you can rest assured did happen.
Would you repeat the URL?
Oh, it's www.trueorigins.us. I should have put it there.
U.S.?
U.S., as in United States.
Could the squint free thinker put that up somewhere?
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be great.
I'll do that.
Yeah, thanks.